It was 1916, 2 years into World War I, and silent movies with a backing orchestra were in, especially comedies. At the time, the DC area already had many theaters of various types, but when Harry Crandall, owner of several theaters already, set out to build DC's newest, largest, and most luxurious, at the corner of 18th and Columbia, he wanted to capitalize on the need for a venue befitting the slowly emerging White Glove era, taking root in the now former Washington Heights district. Fit for all manner of theater entertainment at the time, stage, screen, concerts, speeches. In these episodes, though, researching, fact-finding, getting to the truth is by far the most crucial and time-consuming portion of their production. We all have our biases, myself included, but letting those biases keep me in an echo chamber, only consuming the news I want to hear, isn't the way to objectively gather the facts or create a well-informed opinion. Mr. Crandall would bring in Reginald W. Gear as the designing and lead architect with the goal of making the venue wholly unlike anything of the kind yet built in Washington, with walls of Indiana limestone and Pompeian art brick. At a cost of $77,000, roughly $2 million today, the theater would be designed in the classic revival style for the external facade, with the auditorium featuring posh balconies, box suites, and multiple level tiered seating. There would be capacity for 1,700 guests total, approximately 1,000 seats on the main floor, 500 on the balcony, and room for up to 200 amongst the elevated boxes and other first-class seats. The main entrance along 18th Street, opening into a grand lobby of ivory, pale blue, and gold, adorned by posh draperies and silks, it spanned the length of the building, featuring a candy store for the kids as well. Other amenities would include the gentleman's smoking room, a ladies' reception room with easy chairs and fireplace, and a grand staircase was at the rear of the lobby, leading to the main auditorium. Crandall's Knickerbocker Theater would be the epitome of opulence and entertainment, the crown jewel of Washington, D.C.'s elite. The main auditorium was of wedge shape, like most other theaters in the time period, tapering down to the main stage, the footprint of the theater following the layout of this street corner, pointing roughly north. At 40 feet high relative to street level, it was planned to be comprised of mostly masonry in its structure. To both expedite the building process and fit within the meager budget, structural brick would only be utilized in the south wall. The walls along Columbia Road and 18th Street would be constructed of a hollow tile and made up of mostly windows in order to fit seamlessly with the existing street facade. Windows going completely unused though in a theater like this. The northwest wall along Columbia Road being the weakest, as its number of windows per square foot was the highest. Windows are widely known to reduce a wall's load capacity substantially, with walls featuring them requiring additional reinforcement. When it came time to begin work on the roof framing, the contractor C.A. Schneider & Sons brought on to supply the plate girders and heavy beams for the original concrete and stone slab roof design, due to ongoing war efforts causing shortages and supply delays, requested they replace many of the heavy beams and plate girders with much lighter truss-type supports that would expedite delivery to the job site and meet completion deadlines. These new design proposals were a significant departure from the originals drawn up by the architect, Mr. Gear. However, these revisions would quickly receive sign-off anyway by both Mr. Gear and the city, with no calculations reportedly being made to ensure load capacity of the new materials or designs by any parties involved, not even the steel contractors who proposed them, in particular, their team lead, John Howard Ford. In addition, as construction progressed, more issues revealed themselves. The lead general contractor on site, Frank L. Wagner, did grow uncomfortable with the northwest wall's considerable potential weakness when double-checking its calculations. Mr. Wagner would convince the lead architect to allow internal reinforcement inside the hollow tiling via a concrete belt course along the length of the wall. Once steel framing for the theater was partially in place, Mr. Wagner noticed even more instability. Two of the theater's primary support columns were severely lacking in lateral stiffness. Again, Mr. Wagner received the architect's approval to brace these columns A and B with a steel strut between them. Crandall's Knickerbocker Theater held its formal grand opening on Saturday at 6 p.m. on October 13th, 1917.
The The spirit of the times, the 1920s, was clear in a popular dance of the day called the
By the summer of 1921, the theater had garnered so much popularity that the decision was made to extend the main seating balcony 18 inches, adding 2 to 3 more rows of seating. The war was over after all, and outings at the theater were becoming immensely popular. An additional 3 rows were also installed on a bottom platform. Throughout all these additions, though, no supports would be reinforced. It was January 28, 1922, in a blizzard that would prove later to be one of the largest Washington, D.C. had ever seen, even to this day, had engulfed the area and overwhelmed, well, just about everything. With nearly 2 feet of snow, drifts as high as 16 feet, and significant amounts of ice, it was showing no signs of letting up. The city was effectively shut down, resigned to existing in a winter wonderland for the time being. However, that evening showing of the silent but orchestra-backed comedy, Get Rich Quick Wallingford, would still proceed, with roughly 400 to 500 patrons braving the storm to attend. The inclement weather a possibility as to why the theater was at less than half capacity that fateful evening. In an instant, snow, roof framing, stone slabs, and other debris rained down from above, the collapsing ceiling also bringing the balcony section down with it. The audience and orchestra crushed and consumed in a nightmare of snow and wood and broken steel. There was no warning, no sounds of the roof about to give way, just an instant torrent of deadly debris. The scene caused by the collapse was pure chaos. Due to several factors, though, the ruins would be a site more of disorganized panic than rescue for hours. Some media outlets likened it to a scene out of World War I. The snow hadn't just gathered on the roof, it was still continuing to fall just as heavily as before, further accumulating now on those suffering and trapped. Cries, screams, and painful moans filled the nighttime air as well-meaning bystanders had descended upon the precarious and dangerous ruins in the dark by the hundreds. Relatives desperate to find loved ones, would-be rescuers climbing here and there in the shifting debris. While a handful of police and other rescuers were there within 10 to 15 minutes, many rescue officials were having difficulty reaching the scene due to road conditions, while the area surrounding the theater swarmed with panicked locals. It wasn't until around midnight that some 200 rescuers finally made progress in organizing the scene to begin rescue operations. By roughly 2:30 a.m., 600 rescuers were on scene, comprised of firefighters, soldiers, Marine corpsmen, police, the local Navy Yard's dock workers, and those residents who remained to help provided blankets, hot drinks, and other relief work on the periphery. While rescuers battled the elements, the hazards of a building prone to further collapse, and more importantly, the task of actually getting trapped victims to safety. The balcony having fallen added more complexity to the already horrific rescue scene. Hundreds buried between multiple, twisting layers of debris, inside 40-foot-high walls still barely standing, created a deep pit with points of entry and exit now obscured, buried, or blocked. Designing architect Mr. Gear reportedly assisting in rescue efforts throughout, his knowledge said to have been crucial in the task of navigating the destroyed interior. Local houses, churches, hotels, and nearby businesses opened their doors to the infirmed, as hospitals in the area were quickly overwhelmed. The rescuers meticulously hacking, sawing, and prying away at the mass of metal and wood. Houses, businesses, every location nearby was checked for hacksaws, axes, acetylene torches, and other useful hand tools. One quick-thinking telephone operator at the local Garfield Hospital, Mrs. Dorsey Bush, upon first hearing of the collapse, contacted every local physician she knew of, described what had happened and where, and this led to upwards of 20 doctors being on the scene immediately, providing assistance. The city would call an immediate close to all theaters indefinitely as a precaution as well. In all, 130 plus victims were injured, with 98 or more souls lost. And the loss of life as a result of this tragedy would not end there. Rescue operations carried on tirelessly, with workers taking shifts into the next day and night. Without the modern heavy equipment we have access to today, unable to reach all victims buried beneath. Very few trapped under the rubble for the duration would be rescued, as recovery efforts proceeded in the days following. Throughout all this, the necessary removal, cutting, prying, and handling of debris would unfortunately hamper investigation efforts, but without such a monumental rescue operation, the death toll would have been even higher. Needless to say, cause and responsibility were not easily determined, and many accusations were thrown about initially as a result. Eventually, findings bore out that indeed the facility had several major defects and corners cut in its construction, and failure was only a matter of time. Crucially, the collapse initiated at one of those aforementioned light trusses, which was determined to be even weaker than the steel supplier let on. Truss T11, which was fabricated much too shallow, and seated via a lower cord that wasn't even anchored, and held together with gusset plates only a half inch thick, meant it was doomed from the start. But T11 wasn't the only truss in this condition. They all were. T11 just happened to be the first to give way under the weight of the snow. Having roughly 30% less load capacity than was required, trusses along the northwest wall being seated close to the edge, unanchored, just sitting atop their lower cords, meant the amount of deflection from the weight of the snow resulted in these seating cords being crushed, and the truss then unseating completely from the wall. In addition to this massive load due to snow, though, the northwest wall had been so unstable throughout the building's life, by the time of collapse, it was 5 inches or more out of plumb. Or to oversimplify, the wall being so weak meant it would inevitably lean one way or the other over time, in this instance pulling away slowly over the years from the unanchored trusses, which worsened their already weak seating condition. While this took place, the gusset plates of these trusses being so pathetically under-engineered meant the deflection caused by the wall's movement and subsequent translation through each truss slowly weakened them at the joints closest to the wall over time as well. Even more disconcerting was the fact that, at the time, according to one of the lead inspectors, a Mr. Healy, this truss type of roof is used by all other motion picture theaters of the larger size. This type is popular because it permits the elimination of columns or pillars which, to a certain extent, obstruct the view of the screen. It is considered highly practical and safe. Amongst these issues with the northwest wall and main trusses was a plethora of other potential contributing factors. The structure's main columns were found to be improperly braced, still lacking in lateral support. Lateral support was missing altogether from many trusses. The concrete roof slab was found to have been too thin to meet requirements, and snow removal was also not being performed regularly, if at all. Keep in mind, buildings like this were receiving sign-off by city code inspectors as well, regularly. To play devil's advocate a bit here, it wasn't always due to laziness, crunch culture, or lack of integrity. Many times throughout our history, we tend to simply let it ride when it's an aspect we don't fully understand, until something gives way and society has to learn the hard way. I'm not saying it's right or just, but not necessarily with malicious intent either. Another prime example was the I-35 bridge collapse in Minneapolis. The American infrastructure problem was that, at the time of the bridge's construction, the 1960s, gusset plates and their importance was still not widely understood yet nationwide, leading to findings of many similar bridges having the same exact defects, but then much easier to address and correct now armed with this information. It seems probable that this movement was a slow creep rather than a rapid or violent separation, and in the same degree, it seems probable that the wall was a more important factor in the movement than the steel frame. After the dust had settled and investigations completed, 9 individuals would be held responsible by a coroner's jury, with 5 of those actually indicted on manslaughter charges. The 4 individuals not indicted, the city's building inspector, the city's building designs comptroller, the general contractor, and one of the steel contractors. The 5 indicted on manslaughter, the steel contractor's lead man responsible for the poor truss material and design, Mr. John Howard Ford, the building's lead architect and designer, Mr. Reginald W. Gear, the Northwest Wall's cheap hollow tile contractor, Julian R. Downman, the concrete inspector, Mr. Donald Wallace, along with the building's foreman. Regardless of these findings and indictments, though, and after a stern talking to by the prosecution, you guessed it. They were all completely exonerated of manslaughter charges, and the architect, Mr. Gear, and steel truss supplier, Mr. Ford, found guilty only of negligence. Not one party double-checked their own drawings, let alone held the other accountable throughout the design, revision, and construction phases, with every team and their leaders instead moving forward with budget and deadline as their only driving forces, the intention to cut the theater's budget only in its construction, the rest of the facility remaining incredibly luxurious. The general contractor only speaking up early on because the steel framing was visibly unstable during construction, and calculations for the northwest wall so glaringly poor. Many lawsuits would follow with none successful, as financial liability was never legally assigned. Reginald Wyclef Geer, the designing architect, broken and in a spiral of guilt and despair ever since the collapse, and with his own career in ruins, in 1927, took his own life. 10 years later, Harry M. Crandall, the owner and visionary so personally attached to the Knickerbocker Theater, despondent ever since the collapse, left a final note reading, "Please don't be too hard on me, not for my sake, but for those I am leaving behind me. I'm despondent and miss my theater so much." This note penned just before taking his own life as well in 1937. A new theater was built in its place the following year, dubbed the Ambassador Theater. A story in its own right, the Ambassador stood for 45 years, before it closed in 1968 and was demolished by 69. The lot sat vacant until a bank branch was built on the site in the late 70s. The bank building now shares the site with a public gathering type area. The blizzard from that fateful day, which itself was actually 2 to 3 days long, with drifts ending up as high as 16 feet, still a record in DC to this day, it would be dubbed the Knickerbocker Storm. There is no memorial or plaque that I've been able to find after thorough research, commemorating those victims lost. The Immortus supporters on Patreon get 100% ad-free access to these videos, and they help to keep this channel going. An extra special thank you goes out today to those top-tier supporters, Alex, Jenny, Nathan, and Kat. Thanks so much for watching, everyone, and take care.